So I'm back here on my profile page, github.com/DataKnox. And right here, the interesting thing is this is a read-only page for the most part. I don't see a big button right here that lets me create a repository in the middle of the screen. But as we know, right here in the top, we have the ability to do new repository right there. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to click new repository, and it asks you, what is going to be the name of this repository? It even shows you what the structure of your URL is going to look like. DataKnox/repository name. I'm going to call this LPIC DevOps, like this. And this is a publicly resolvable name, so it does have to be unique. In this case, it is unique. It can even offer repository names. Great repository names are short and memorable. Need inspiration? How about effective Eureka? Cool. I mean, if that's what you want to do, that's great. You can give it a description. We'll call this LPIC DevOps training content. Now, if your content, if your repository is going to be public, descriptions do help people who browse for repositories to work on or to gather inspiration from. So having a good description here can actually help people who are, you know, curious as to what's going on. Is this going to be accessible to the public? Or is it going to be private, where only people that you invite to your repository can actually see the code and work on it? So even if someone has the URL to your repository, if it's private, they'll actually just get a 404 content not found error. They have to be explicitly granted access to it. And when I say that, they have to have a GitHub account and you invite them by their GitHub username, not their email, not some special code or anything, not some link. You invite them by their GitHub username. So just keep that in mind. Now we have the ability to initialize the repository with some standard files. A README file is a great one to start with. A git ignore file is another really important one if you know what kind of project you're going to be working on. For instance, if I'm working with a React application, I want to make sure it's going to ignore things like, you know, my node modules dependencies or, you know, Rust or Python or anything like that where environment variables need to be omitted. So if I use Python right here, I know I can put some Python code in there and it'll automatically tell Git, don't track changes on these specific types of files because they're just used by the local environment or they're going to take up a huge amount of space. If I am going to be creating open source software for the world to use, I can apply standardized licenses that dictate how this code should be used and how it can be used, you know, in public settings or corporate settings, whatever. So this is really, really important for if you're actually creating tools that other users are going to use in production environments, you can actually say and put some terms on this. Because the one thing that can happen, you see this every now and then, someone creates open source software, then a company comes along and copies it, basically makes a fork of it, changes a color scheme, and then starts charging for it. So these types of licenses kind of start to more or less put a stop to that kind of activity. So that's why these licenses are here. Now, don't worry about this Azure stuff. We're not talking about Azure DevOps, not yet at least. I'm going to create this repository, and my repository has now been created. Great. So how do I actually work on it? This is a Git repository that now lives in the cloud. So when I want to work on this, what do I do? What I need to do is I need to clone this repository. That is the term cloning. I'm going to clone it to my computer. So I'm going to go to code right here. And you see under HTTPS, I'm going to click the copy button for the URL. Now with Git installed on my computer, we'll just go full screen and blow it up nice and big. I'll go into my code folder where I'm just going to save code. And the command is git clone, and then you paste in the URL. Just like that. So now it's made a copy of this. If I do LSL, we can see, where is it? There's an LPIC, right? Oh, right, because it's sorted by capital letters first. LPIC DevOps right here at the top of the screen. So there's that folder that now exists. What does VS Code think? I'll bring VS Code onto the screen. We'll add the LPIC folder here. So I'll go into code and then LPIC DevOps, and I'll add that folder. And sure enough, it sees the git ignore and the readme file. Let's make a change to the readme file real quick. We'll add a H2 header that says new line, and I'll put, I am typing a fun new line. Command S to save it. Now, just like we've always done with GitHub, we're going to do a stage and a commit, and we'll say alter readme file and create a commit. So think about this at this point, right? We had this cloud repo in GitHub, okay? I then made a copy of it at this exact time down here to my computer. I'm going to draw a little laptop like this. Then what did I do? What I did was I had it here and I added a new commit, didn't I? So now I'm here. My head is here. The problem is that GitHub doesn't know about this new commit yet, and it doesn't know where the head is. I've made this change, and right now that change exists only on my local computer. But if I look at GitHub, if I clear the screen and flip back to GitHub right here, and I refresh the screen, and I go into my README, I still only see the LPIC DevOps training content line. I don't see my new line added there, do I? So what needs to happen now? Now that I've had this commit created on my local computer, we can do a git push. What does that do? It takes all new commits since the clone and pushes those back up to GitHub. So to do this, I can click the dot, 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 and I can click push. Boop, just like that. You see it spins and it's done. So all of the buttons here in VS Code kind of gray out, they kind of disappeared. When I come back here and refresh, hey, look at that. Now my new commit is here. And I see the new commit that was created just 2 minutes ago. The commit description was alter readme file. Now, alternatively, let's pretend a coworker edited the file and pushed their changes back up into this repository. So what I'll do is I'll click edit the file right here on the screen. I'll go down here and say coworker's line. This is Bob's line. Just something like that. You can edit the text files right here on the fly, but importantly, this is still a Git repository. There's no save button. Instead, what are we doing? We're going to create a new commit when we save this. So I'll click commit right here. It asks me for the commit message. We'll say Bob did some work and commit it directly. So now this, according to GitHub, looks like this, doesn't it? Because Bob, quote unquote, Bob pushed a new commit up into GitHub. So when I come back here to my computer, look at this. VS Code automatically detected one incoming change. It knows that GitHub got a new commit that we don't have yet. In fact, we can actually see that commit right here in the source control graph. The purple one, Bob did some work, and it shows me a little cloud symbol right there on the screen that indicates there's this commit from the remote repository. GitHub is known as the remote repository in this case. So when I want to get this change now on my local computer, I can either click the sync changes button or I can do a pull. Obviously, if we did a push before to push our commits up into GitHub, when we want to get new commits down from GitHub, we're going to pull them down. So I'll click pull right here. And now my local computer shows the new coworker's line. So this is all the same stuff that we did in Git, staging and commit. The only thing that we're adding now to the mix is push and pull. But it all started because we cloned the repository from GitHub. When we clone the repository from GitHub, it automatically knows that GitHub is the source. It is the remote source of truth. So this repository automatically knew, okay, this is a clone of a GitHub repository because we did clone it from GitHub. Therefore, we have the ability to track changes that are happening on GitHub. As our coworkers are collaborating and pushing their own changes, we now have the ability to pull their changes into our code locally. And now we start to see how synchronization of code happens across teams.